Thanks, Kevin. I'm going to try to go through and just give you a brief overview initially of who we are and what we do if you're not familiar with us. U.S. Premium Beef is one of the owners of National Beef. National Beef, the fourth largest packer in the United States, with two plants here in Southwest Kansas, one in Dodge City and one in Liberal. So we are one of the owners. We in turn are owned by producers of all different types and kinds. Kevin and Tyler recently became, can I say that publicly? Sure. Recently became unit holders in U.S. Premium Beef. We will add them to what we call a qualified seed stock supplier program, just as a little bit of free advertising for them to say, hey, these are people that know our company, they've invested in it, understand how it works, and understand what producers like yourselves need to supply cattle through our system. And let me just stop and say that everything that I'm gonna present to you here really ties together with what these guys have already presented to you. So you're gonna hear a lot of me too and thumbs up to what they've said. And also just to remind you, not to steal my own thunder, but to remind you that cattle, like Kevin said, these cattle are gonna be fed. Okay, so maybe you're not feeding them and retaining ownership on them directly, but we hope that they end up at our door. So the way that producers participate when they do sell fed cattle to us, whether that's a large feed yard or a private feeder, someone like yourself retaining ownership at a custom feed yard, whatever it may be, the way to participate and sell the cattle to us is that we ask them to first become an associate member. You can do that for just $100, or the feed yard that you work with may already have their membership and they may be still sold in the name of the feed yard. But every animal that goes through U.S. Premium Beef has to be tied to a delivery right. And so that's what Kevin and Tyler purchased recently. So they now have some delivery rights that they will be able to make available to customers if they want to. It's up to them how they want to use them. Feed yards have them. So that's what we're saying here is you can lease from a feed yard or seed stock supplier. If you know of someone that you can lease directly on your own, you can do it that way. If people have extras, they can turn them over to us and we facilitate that. When we do that, we charge $6 a head. And that gets access to the grid and some of the other benefits that we're gonna discuss here in just a minute. But what I was trying to allude to here just a second ago was that, hey, if you don't retain ownership through slaughter, another option is certainly just the simple market your feeders to a U.S. Premium Beef member that's gonna in turn send them to us. So wherever you sell them to either one of these guys or privately or whatever, I encourage you to tell Kevin and Tyler, hey, this is what I'm gonna do. And then I think they'll probably be happy to promote them and share information with our feed yards so that they can go bid on them, whether they're being sold on the video or at an auction or privately. So a lot of different ways that this can all come together. Just an update on where we're at as far as how the program's working. Last year, 2017, our overall average was $49 per head premium. Now, when I say premium, what I mean by that is comparing what we pay for these cattle on the grid versus the alternative of just selling them on the cash live market. Okay, that's the average across the board. Now, again, to put that into perspective, yes, there's some really good designed genetic kind of cattle that are really ringing a bell. They would tend to be in this upper 25%, that's about $92 a head over the cash. But within that overall average, there's still a lot of cattle that are coming from some bigger feed yards that were just purchased at sale barns and videos without necessarily a whole lot of known background. Not really what I would call designed cattle. Good cattle, managed well. But there's a wide variety of cattle is what I'm getting at. So so far this year, it's very similar results. So far in 2018, we're at about $49 a head. Overall average in that top end is $85 a head, more than the market, than the cash market. Other benefits that we offer is we can provide carcass data to the person that sells the cattle to us at no additional charge. And what I mean by that is we can record the actual ear tags. If you've got tags in your calves that goes back to something, cows, bulls, whatever it may be, that you've got recorded to that, then we can do that at no additional charge. We do pay a little bit of a freight credit on the fats when they come to market. Some grids charge freight to the seller. We'll offer a credit. That accounts to about 100 miles of freight on a load of fats coming to the plant. The other benefit is what we call market access, and that's kind of relevant right now. Cattle numbers are high. These show lists get a little bit bigger, and occasionally larger feed yards have cattle to sell, and the packers are pretty well filled up on their needs, and that feed yard will have to come back to a customer that owns those cattle and say, hey, I know you wanted to sell your cattle on the open cash market, but I couldn't get them sold. They didn't take them. Well, if you're a U.S. premium beef unit holder, if you own your own delivery rights, and you turn them in this week, you know they're going to get shipped next week. You know they're going to be on the same formula or grid that we use to price the cattle, and so you know that you don't have to get stuck overfeeding these cattle in that kind of a situation. So a little bit more about National Beef. It's a company that tries to be very efficient. We're number four in the scheme of size. But so we try to be as efficient as the bigger competitors, but we also try to be very much into value-added programs. These are some of our brands. We're also very big into export, anything that's related to value-added. So low cost, high revenue is a nice combination to have. And so you'll see some Angus brands. We're one of the largest processors of certified Hereford. Some of our product goes to a couple of facilities on the East Coast where we'll take it out of the box, out of the bag, cut it down to individual portions, label it, and even price it for the retailer, and then send it to the grocery store that's going to take it out of that box and put it directly in the case. So we're responsible for food safety and the distribution and so forth, and the labor. So that's something that packers are beginning to do more and more of to provide more service to their customers. When we talk about our grid and just try to explain it in what I think are simple terms, is basically our job is to stand here and hold a target for cattle feeders to shoot at with the cattle. You hit the bullseye, you can make a lot of money. If you land out here totally off the mark, you may get less than the industry average cash price. But to describe what that target is made up of, it's definitely, that bullseye is definitely high marbling cattle. But I like to also say that it's got a big bullseye. We're not really looking for one exact specific kind of cattle. We're also not necessarily restrictive to perfect cattle. And I'll get into that just a little bit more detail in a minute, but different kinds of cattle can land in that bullseye by maximizing the strengths that they have, and different cattle have different strengths. So some programs that are based on one branded beef program can be really restrictive, and I like to say that they'd have a really small bullseye because you've got to have that one specific thing. Again, continuing with this bullseye metaphor, if you will, it's all built on consumers being willing to pay for a product, whether that be a branded beef program or these higher quality grade products. They're willing to pay for it. Producers, of course, are saying, well, pay me what my cattle are worth, and the grid and trickle down economics works. And we like to say that we like to lead you as a producer with a dollar rather than beat you with a stick, right? So, but the demand for the product has to be there to begin with. This just shows the 20-year average of what our premiums have been. They've increased because our cattle have gotten better, our grid's gotten a little bit better. We've added in some new additional programs over the years. And so we've been in the neighborhood of upper 40s to $50 here for a little while. breaking that down a little further to give you an idea of the range. So last year that average was $49. The top end was about $92. Even our bottom end was almost $10 a head. Now, there's still some groups in there that are negative, okay? Don't get me wrong. But what I'm getting at is even the bottom end has, on average, has done fairly well. Now, to break it down and say, well, where does that $50 come from, that premium of $49 or $50? Each and every year, quality grade is usually the biggest bar on that chart. So again, that's why I'm saying it's a marbling grid. That's where most of the dollars are coming from. All things related to quality grade, that's marbling. The USDA quality grade and branded beef programs, all those things together. The second biggest bar on the chart is yield or dressing percentage, and that's just simply the fraction of carcass weight divided by live weight. And the reason that's a factor is because we price the cattle on a carcass weight basis on a grid, but the standard that most people compare to is the live cash market. So carcass weight divided by live weight makes a difference. The way you make money doing that is if you can generate more total dollars by selling carcass weight at a carcass price versus live weight at a live price, then you can generate more total dollars, okay? Yield grade is another factor, but it's usually on average not a big deal. Of course, fours and fives are the fatter, lighter muscled cattle. We're gonna compare your cattle to what we're buying on the open cash market. If you're bringing more yield grade fours and fives than what's out there in the industry at the time, then there's gonna be a discount. But as you can see, on average, it's really been small, only minus $1.33 last year. Outweights, of course, are always gonna be a negative. We don't have a premium. These are the ones that are too light or too big, and the heavies start at carcass weight of 1050. Not a live weight, but a carcass weight of 1050. But as you know, cattle have been getting bigger for forever, all right? I don't see that trend changing. Natural, we do have a natural program. It's not very many cattle. The premium per head for natural is quite large. Like right now, it's around $225 a head, but that just gives you an idea spread out across all of our cattle. It's only a dollar average because that's over all of the cattle. So two big bars, the rest of them are kind of small. You might look at these two and say, well, it's easy to have less outweights and less yield grade discount if you just didn't feed the cattle so long. But guess what? Those two big bars get bigger as we feed cattle longer. So a lot of what I do is just helping people understand the dynamics. I've got a background in nutrition and feedlot nutrition and running closeouts for customers. And so helping people understand, well, how long do you want to feed the cattle that you own in the feed yard? Okay, you may know that on the cash market, the last thing you want to do is overfeed the cattle because your cost of gain is going up rapidly. You don't want to get stuck in a position where it costs more to put on a pound of gain than what you're going to sell it for. But on a grid basis, remember I told you where you're selling off a carcass weight. I told you yield goes up as you feed them longer. And as you feed them longer, quality grade rewards get even bigger. So we like to say that those last couple weeks on feed can actually be your most valuable because that's when you're building a lot of value and you can get rewarded for it. This just shows the average choice and prime that our cattle and the industry average in red have been over the last 20 years. We've always been better than industry average. Both have increased a lot in the last, 10 years. And I've been asked several times, been asked to submit some survey comments and different things. We've just gotten a lot better with our genetic tools. Breeders and now commercial cattlemen can select genetics that will do some pretty amazing things. And then we also talk about managing cattle to better express their genetics. Remember, we're talking about genetic potential. I probably had the potential to be 6'5". I only ended up being 6'4", foot or 6'1" because I got sick a few times. I ate too much chicken. And I didn't get there, all right? So we talk about managing your cattle to get as close to that potential as possible. So to summarize, what kind of cattle work on this grid? Well, again, a big bullseye. A lot of different kinds of cattle can work. English and English crossbreds work quite well. We get a lot of those. They usually excel in quality grade. Again, that's the biggest bar on that chart. Their weakness is they may not be quite as big on the other bar, which is dressing percentage. The opposite, continental exotic influence cattle can work okay because they do excel in yield, but their downfall might be that they have less genetics for marbling. We get a lot of mixed crossbred put together cattle that might be bought out of sale barns in those small groups. Maybe they're a known background, maybe they're not. And a lot of English continental cross cattle. So we're not here to tell you what exact breeds to raise. We do like to see people go into qualified seed stock suppliers that know what we're looking for and can help you get there. But if you get there with breed A, breed B, or breed C, or a three-way cross of all of the above, that's your choice, right? I do work with people on using those tools that like a breeder can help you with to get there, but we're not here to tell you they've got to be this breed or that breed. They don't have to be black. If you want to raise straight Herefords, baldy, red baldies or black baldies or whatever, that's your choice. What doesn't work is if you're trying to sell your cattle green, by that I mean not enough days on feed in the feed yard. Okay, so if there are still some people that have only sold cattle on the cash market. They're so ingrained with that thought that, oh, we don't want to overfeed these cattle. If that's what you're doing, then yeah, you don't want to overfeed them. But as you move into grid marketing, it's a different way to market the cattle. And if they're sold green, then they're not going to yield as well, and you're not going to maximize that marbling. If we place cattle in the feed yard that are really big, let's just say 9 weights and above, and they're growthy, and their steers, you better expect that you're gonna end up with some heavyweight discounts if they've got any growth in them at all. Roughing out through the winter, you know, some people will buy the light end of a fall run, just hold them over through the winter with hopes to go to grass the next spring, make yearlings out of them, and then they come into the feed yard middle of the, or late summer as a big old yearling. Because we went through a phase there in the winter where we just didn't really give them a whole lot of groceries, those cattle end up not doing quite as well from a marbling standpoint. So that's one thing that if people did it, they shied away from doing. But I like to compare grid marketing to some other things. Like growing up, my dad had to start doing no-till farming, right? And he hated it, he cussed it. But once he adopted it and said, okay, we're gonna make this work, he made it work, and he made it work quite well. So if you're willing to try some new things, kind of like what you were saying earlier, be willing to try some different things, don't get too stuck in your rut. And they may just be little changes that can make a pretty big difference. We do not buy dairy breed cattle, we don't buy high percentage Brahma cattle, and by that we mean they look over 50%. Brangus or Brahma cattle, rather. But to sum up, things that we've sure noticed pretty early on in our 20-year history is that, yeah, genetics certainly makes a difference. That's your genetic potential. But everything below there on this list are things that we're doing to try to get to that potential, right? So we want to feed them right, nutrition for the whole life of the animal, and even before birth, the management and nutrition of mom while she's carrying that calf will make a difference. Of course, the feedlot management, again, how long do we feed them? How many days on feed? We certainly want to keep them healthy. We want to manage growth promotants. We don't shy away from them. We're not here to say that you shouldn't use them. I would say that most of our big feed yards are using just as many growth promotants as anybody else, but we do try to use them wisely and make sure that they've got adequate groceries to fuel and feed that. Just a little bit of data real quick, just to drive home the whole what has value thing. This is last year's cattle. I have a database of every individual animal. Almost 800,000 head last year that we ran through. And so these are the steers, and I excluded the naturals. So the top row is the primes, the CAB carcasses, the commodity choice, select, and then no rolls would be everything below select. And here's the dollar value per head, and here's the differences. So primes were worth $112 per head more than the CABs. CABs were $59 more than the commodity choice, $155 more than select, and so forth. But the other thing to note is, here's your price per head, here's your price per hundred. Average yield grades, yes, notice that they're a little bit higher yield grade, up higher on the quality scale. So again, you can't expect to get some quality grade without getting some days on feed to allow them to get there and express their genetic potential. But also note that, hey, we're going up in carcass weight as on average as we go up in quality grade. So this is not just a function of their quality grade, that's what's gonna drive their price per pound, but it's also affected by the pounds that you sell. And again, that's why we talk about, hey, how long should we feed these cattle? And I've been telling a lot of people lately that once you get these genetics built up for marbling, we really ought to feed them those calves longer to give them more days on feed to express that potential to get up to that higher level of marbling. It's not just gonna happen on its own. Just like if you had high growth genetics and you didn't feed them, they're not gonna grow as well, right? Same way with marbling. This is an example of where we've got what we call qualified feed yards. Qualified meaning, again, like the seed stock program, these are feed yards that own a minimum of 1,000 of our delivery rights. A lot of them own way more than that. And so if you're looking for a custom feed yard, we would highly recommend that you go there. They know how to manage your cattle. They know us, they know how our system works. And but the big thing lately is that they have those delivery rights. We've been turning people away lately because we are running short on delivery rights because cattle numbers are higher, shipment numbers have been a little bit higher, and our program is working, so the demand has been pretty high. So I'm gonna stop there. I look forward to questions.
Okay, thank you, Brian.